Aloha, YouTube. Today's video is a project for a college class, but I'm hoping that you'll learn a little bit about somebody who made a big impact on church history. So stick around, comment down below if you have any questions or thoughts about what I discussed, and click on that subscribe button and the bell icon, and click on the like button if you really like the video. All right, I appreciate it. Now let's get on to the video.
Yesterday, December 7th, 1941, a date which will live in infamy. The United States of America was suddenly and deliberately attacked by naval and air forces of the Empire of Japan.
2,403 people died on that day. Of those, 1,177 were on the USS Arizona, which lies behind me now. Even today, it still has oil coming up from the metal in the ship underneath the water. But what President Roosevelt didn't mention in his video that day was what was going on here in Hawaii. See, the first warplanes came and dropped bombs at 7:55 in the morning. A lot of people were either getting up, having breakfast, or going to church. But speaking of the church, just 10 years earlier, during the Great Depression, they had some hard times, just like today during the pandemic. As employment went down, so did the tithes and offerings to the church. Many churches found themselves relying on volunteers and the pastors themselves doing a lot of the work of the church. While the subject matter of today's video was not here during Pearl Harbor's attack, there was a guy here by the name of Jim Downing. Jim Downing, others know him as Navigator number 6, which I'll talk about the Navigators in a little bit. He was stationed here on the USS West Virginia. Now, during the attack, of course, all the ships were lined up right next to each other. So when the attack happened, Jim Downing actually went down the gun barrel to the other ship next door to try to help the sailors get back off that ship and get to safety on land. Jim not only survived the attack on Pearl Harbor, he also survived a nuclear incident gone wrong. Castle Bravo was a nuclear explosion that was way bigger than it was supposed to be. And at the time, Jim was commanding a ship. But if you want to read more about Jim, you can do that in his book, On the Other Side of Infamy. And I'll link that in the description below. What I do want you to learn in today's video is about a guy named Dawson Trotman. Now, Dawes had an interesting way of life, and we're going to get into his personal life, his spiritual life, and his ministry work. But when Dawes decided to follow God and his calling in his life, he did something that the church really hadn't heard of before, and if they had heard of it, it wasn't really talked about much. And it's this idea of follow-up. Today, follow-up is called something different. We kind of Christianized the word, and we call it discipleship making. But all it really is bringing others alongside, teaching what you know, so that they can go and teach others. Before I talk about discipleship making, I want to talk a little bit about Dawson Trotman. When Dawson was young, he would see his mom every day put a dime into a jar. And one day he thought to himself, you know, mom wouldn't miss just one dime from that jar. So he fished out a dime one day, took it down to the candy shop and bought a bunch of candy. He would eventually get sick from that candy, and he was worried that his mom was going to find out. He would later on talk in a conference about how being a liar was a coward, because a coward was fearful, and a liar was fearful of the consequences that might happen if they're caught. So therefore, a liar is just a coward. But back to his childhood days. After that day, he didn't get caught. His mom didn't understand why he was sick, but didn't really question it either. But after he was successful, he did it again, and then again, and then again. It didn't just stop from a dime from the jar. As he got into school and was on the student council, he would start stealing from the funds of the student council's fundraisers. He would even end up being valedictorian. His topic for his speech? Morality versus legality. While in high school, he even joined the Boy Scouts. You know, giving the oath every time you're there, about being trustworthy and honoring. Those were words that he would say, but he wouldn't live them. It had become such a normal part of his life that he decided that after high school, that was who he was. He couldn't change. There was no hope. After that, he would find himself in the lake at a party, and a friend of his, a girl, was starting to drown, and he went over to try to help her. But he wasn't strong enough to help them both. And so while he was trying to help her, he started sinking underneath the water. And he remembers talking to God and saying, "God, if you'll get me out of this, I'll do whatever you want." Well, this wouldn't be the last time that he would say those words, but we'll get to that in a little bit. When he was 20 years old in 1926, that's when he found the Lord. But we'll talk about that in his spiritual life. It was a few years after that that he met Lila and married her. They had 5 kids together. And then on one fateful day at Shroon Lake in New York, Dawes once again found himself in a lake, drowning, trying to help another survive. However, this time, there was no boat to rescue them both. The girl that he was trying to save was rescued, and Dawes died that day. If you remember the story about Dawes when he was drowning in the lake, and he said, "God, if you get me out of this, I'll do whatever you want," and the boat showed up, well, Dawes didn't follow through with his end of the bargain. Instead, he went back to drinking, back to smoking, and just all around living his life. He recalled one time that his mom, because he kept on getting in trouble, told him, "If you ever got arrested, I would surely die." Well, one night he did get arrested, and he thought about her. Once again, he talked to God, saying, "God, if you'll get me out of this, I'll do whatever you want." Well, the officer that arrested him that night decided to let him go and take him to church. And Sunday night when he got to church, something interesting started to happen. Now, of course, part of this young adult group that he was with, there were pretty girls there and some competitive guys there. And he found out about this competition where every team would get points, and those points would add up. And at the end of the week, whoever had the most points wouldn't have to chip in for pizza the following week. Well, Dawes didn't like to spend any of his own money for anything, but he wanted to use it for his own things. So when he found out that all they had to do was memorize some scripture and they would get points for every scripture they memorized, he was going to do it. And the following week, he was the only one that would memorize all 10 of the verses they were assigned that week. 10 verses got him 50 points, and nobody could match that. And then the following week, another 10. And this would be the start of Dawes and his ministry. So as he started following the Lord, and those memory verses kept on coming up, he started to teach others. He taught high school students, and principals, and teachers. And it wasn't long after that that his friends started getting him involved in ministry to the Navy. After all, they were in LA, and there was a base right near where they lived. Dawson met a sailor by the name of Les Spencer, and Les started learning the foundations of Christian growth. Les and Dawes would spend many hours praying and reading the Bible and working on their scripture memory. While the video on your screen is overlooking Pearl Harbor here in Hawaii, it's much like how Dawson looked on the Navy base in LA. He would sit on the hillside early in the morning as the sun was coming up and pray over the sailors and the ships that he saw down in the harbor. One day, one of Les Spencer's shipmates asked him, "What's changed in your life? Why are you different?" And Les brought his friend Dawson and said, "Dawes, teach him what you taught me." Little did he know that he had 2 Timothy 2:2 on the mind. 2 Timothy 2:2 in the New Living Translation says, "You have heard me teach things that have been confirmed by many reliable witnesses. Now teach these truths to other trustworthy people who will be able to pass them on to others." This was one of the verses that Dawson memorized early in his scripture memory days. So Dawes looked at Les and said, "You teach him. I've taught you what I can teach you. Now it's your turn." And thus was born discipleship. Les did teach the sailor, and then went on to teach another, and then another. Eventually, 125 men of the USS West Virginia, the same ship that Jim Downing was on, were working on scripture memory. By the end of World War II, thousands of sailors and hundreds of ships around the world were involved with scripture memory and walking a Christ-filled life. So now you might be asking yourself, well, what's the secret? How did he do that? Well, let's look at some of his ministry. In 1933, Dawson officially launched the Navigators organization. They're still around today, and they have 2,700 missionaries around the world in 50 different countries. Just over 1,100 of those are in locations around the U.S. The Navigators is much more than an outreach to just the military.
now they have her outreach to college students, to those more experienced, let's say. But the mission remains the same, to go and make disciples and teaching others to teach what you have taught them. But let's take a look now at what DAWS did in the beginning as the Navigators were just getting kicked off. So as I discussed, DAWS is very interested in scripture memorization. He knew it was an important part of a Christian's life. And so back when he got started, he would make these little cards, and these cards were about the size of a cigarette pack. Now, of course, they weren't nicely printed and they weren't in this like leather bound little case, but he would have this little pocketbook with these cards, and they were just the right size to fit in the cigarette pocket of the uniform. Nowadays, the topical memory system is something that you can purchase, and it has all the different cards in it that you can tear out, and about 4 to 6 different versions of the Bible that you can memorize from. So if the NIV is your flavor, or the ESV and so forth, you can do that from this book. And this is just a nice little way to keep all your cards in one place, keep them in your pocket, and be able to work on your scripture memory no matter where you are in the world or in your workplace. Something else that DAWS had a flavor for was napkin ministry. What do I mean by napkin ministry? Well, it's just what it sounds like. You know, he'd be at a bar with his friends or around a table at a coffee shop, and he would talk about ministry. He would talk about his faith in Christ and all that kind of thing. And he would do things, and he would just draw a picture while he's sitting there talking with his friends or talking with somebody new, and just trying to exclaim, like, okay, what is this faith all about? What is Christ all about? And why do we need Christ in our life? This drawing here is known as the bridge illustration. And the bridge illustration has a few verses that they would memorize, talking about our sin and about sin's penalty and about our assurance of salvation in God and how we must receive Christ to be able to receive that salvation. The pit here was that, you know, we always talk about works and how it's part of our salvation, and DAWS didn't believe that. And so he would draw this bridge illustration to show why Christ had to pay the penalty for us on the cross. Another illustration that's prevalent in today's ministry of the Navigators is called the wheel illustration. And again, he would take that, you know, another napkin, he would grab another napkin on the table, and he would start drawing this wheel on the table, on the napkin. And of course, you know, they wouldn't know what they're looking at, but he would say, the wheel is the obedient Christian. And to be obedient, you need something to draw the power from. And so that power comes from Christ in the center, and that's where the cross is. And then each spoke had memory verses that go along with it as well. And all of these would help identify things that were important for a Christian, such as the prayer going up, the word from God coming down to us so that we could read the word, and then witnessing to others and fellowshipping. You can read more about it in DAWS' book, Dawson Trotman in His Own Words. In it, you can find journal entries that are photocopied from a long time ago, as well as, you know, his direct thoughts on obedience. So real discipleship making started in 1933. And up until 1947, that was pretty much all DAWS focused on. But in 1947, another guy by the name of Billy Graham started his crusades, going around to stadiums and arenas and drawing thousands to Christ. But Billy heard about the follow-up, and he knew that he couldn't do follow-up with 3,000, 4,000 people. So Billy reached out to DAWS one day and said, DAWS, I need you to come help with follow-up. DAWS resisted at first because the Navigators was where he needed to focus. He needed to continue focus on the follow-up. But the story goes that Billy grabbed him by the shoulders and said, who else has your understanding of the follow-up? If not you, DAWS, then who? So DAWS relented and he went to help Billy for a little while, but he did the same thing, taught others to teach others. DAWS had a personal and significant contribution to multiple ministry organizations of today, one of which is the organization I work for, Youth for Christ. He also had a hand in Campus Crusade, InterVarsity, and the Billy Graham Association. So did you know who Dawson Trotman was before this video? If not, please leave a comment down below and let me know your thoughts. Leave a like if you enjoyed the content, and consider clicking on that subscribe button and the bell icon to get notified of future uploads. Mahalo and aloha.